I used to not believe in miracles, and after you live them, you have to believe.
I was diagnosed with stage 4 Hodgkin's lymphoma, and it was the beginning of a 2.5-year journey just to reach that point of remission. Throughout all that, I was told that there was maybe a 5% chance of me being able to have children. I mean, there was no reason we would necessarily think that this would happen for us. And then it did. Yes, bonus baby as well. 2 for the price of 1. And they came with a bang. Just before I was 22 weeks and I was feeling a little bit of tightness in my abdomen, they wanted to put me on magnesium to do whatever they could to keep these babies in until viability day, which is 24 weeks.
They were born at 23 weeks, 3 days. Bennett was 1 pound, 3 ounces at birth. Savannah was 1 pound, 4.
That is before any human being is expected to survive at all. And they are a world record in that regard.
UC Davis sent up 2 separate teams by plane to take each one down.
Transporting preemies from as far away as Reading is a big undertaking.
It was tough saying goodbye and seeing them go and being away from them already. But I know that's where they needed to be.
I just sat in a rocking chair looking at Savannah, feeling totally defeated, just crying. Dr. Noel just comes on up. He said, "I will treat every baby, including yours, like it's my own." And that was exactly what we needed to hear.
His second day, Bennett had a liver rupture. By the time I got here, he already had improved.
Bennett was having a hernia repair.
I was fixing his hernia, but I noticed that Bennett was a little bit smaller than the average preemie.
You know, we were nervous, terrified parents, but Dr. Farmer took the time to explain everything to us step by step.
Bennett all of a sudden became one of the most amazing hernia patients I had ever had.
After an ultrasound and an MRI, it was discovered that he had this cyst on his brainstem.
Dr. Lee is the neurosurgeon that helped us with Bennett's VP shunt and what life would look like after having a VP shunt placed.
You know, I think it's difficult already to have a baby. And then add on top of that, that your child is critically ill. That is overwhelming.
Being able to have your healthcare providers be people that you 100% fully trust to make these decisions is huge.
Yeah, I think the first thing is that we have a good team. And you know, I think what really makes us strong is our multidisciplinary care model.
UC Davis is here to provide that highest end tertiary and quaternary care to the people of Sacramento and even beyond.
We were in the best place that we could possibly be for these two to give them the optimal chance to survive. Finally, being out of the woods, so to speak, it makes you appreciate things like being able to sit down and have a meal with one another and have a meal there while enjoying the company of our 2 little babies, our precious little babies. We're just so pleased that they're here with us.
Even though they're here, I can't wait to meet them, to know their personalities.
They're special little human beings and they've touched so many lives already. But we're so glad to be home. From the bottom of our hearts, we have to say thank you to the UC Davis Children's Hospital for keeping our miracle children alive and here with us today. They wouldn't be here without the phenomenal care, and we just are eternally grateful.
I think it's great. He always knew he was going to make it and come back and be as strong as before, if not better. Every nurse and doctor, especially Drs. Weinberg Lee, were just amazing. I've always respected them, but I have a newfound respect.
When I was in the hospital, I was wearing a Superman shirt, and there was a picture posted on Facebook, and then one of our friends, she said to change your profile thing to Superman, so then it kind of just carried on.
Hundreds and hundreds of people changed it to Superman, yeah. It was really inspiring seeing him be here today, and all his friends and stuff being here was great.
My name's Teddy, and I'm 9 years old.
Teddy the Tornado.
He's a busy kid. He's in choir, scouts, plays soccer.
Taekwondo.
He swims, we do all of it. Does it all.
It's hard to see now, but Teddy was born blind.
He was born with congenital cataracts.
He basically had the lenses of an 80-year-old man.
And at birth, he was pretty much blind. It's a hereditary condition. Started with my great-grandmother. She passed it down to my grandfather, who passed it down to my mother, who passed it down to my sister and me.
I first met Teddy when he was newborn, in the first few weeks of his life. When Teddy's cataracts were discovered, they were of the type that requires early surgery for best vision potential. Teddy had surgery on one eye, and then a week later had surgery on his second eye. And because when you take the cataract out, you're taking the focuser of the eye out, we replaced the focusing ability of that eye by placing a contact lens on the surface of the eye. Once he was completely healed from his surgery, then the real work began. They showed us how to remove the contacts, put in the contacts, take them out, you know, on a daily basis, and put them in his eyes, and worked with us for hours on that. We saw Dr. O'Hara about every 6 weeks, and then went to every 3 months, and then every 6 months now. So he's come a long way. Putting in and out of the contacts was extremely difficult on an infant. It's kind of impossible at times. Now he's 9 years old and able to get his own contacts in and out of his own eyes at 9. Today, you wouldn't know that Teddy has a disability at all.
Because you can't tell. Nobody knows. It's an invisible disability now.
And without UC Davis's care and treatment, Teddy's life would be a shadow of what it currently is. None of this has ever been easy, but with the improvement in technology and the great care that we received at UC Davis, it's changed all of our lives, especially Teddy's, forever.
Back. Are you out for some Rocket League? Alright, took a while, a bit longer than I wanted to there. Eat fast, but not too. Yeah, I don't know why the I was so low. It was fine for me until the moment. But yeah, UC Davis
gave me that link, or some of the videos from a link, and I put it in a playlist last minute, in the last minute thing. Play during a break, or people were interested in learning what Extra Life is about, sort of thing. So a lot of sad stories there. Definitely brought a tear to my eye at least last night. It was a lot of sad stories. But hopefully we can help out. Alright, it doesn't look like anyone wants to enter the giveaway, so we can do one later. That's fine. You have a lot of blood spilled. My voice is late too. Well, it depends on your own audio setup. So you've got a slider on Twitch, and then you've got a volume slider on your PC as well, or Mac or whatever you have. It all depends on your setup, because I can only turn it up so much past that. I know generally my microphone is low, but I've put it up a lot louder than what it should be. Yeah, there's not much else I can do, sorry. I've put it up as much as I can without over boosting it, because otherwise it'll start to sound staticky, so I can't turn it up any more than that. And same with the videos, I tried turning them up as much as I could. I can't turn them up anymore. I don't know. Wait, didn't you say your pet chewed through your cord? Your headset? That might be why. Possibly, I don't know. I'm just guessing. Are you still up from some Rocket Legacy, or...? If not, it's all good. I've got a few games lined up either way. No, not you, Issy's headset. Got chewed through or something, I think she said earlier. That might be a reason why hers isn't picking up stuff at much volume. And you said your speakers aren't that great, right? Yeah, that might be causing the volume not to be as loud. Because everyone else said I was fine earlier on. You're up for some? Cool. Let me just turn my controller.